Incredibly, it happened. In an English street, a bank was burnt out by rioters. The riot propelled St. Paul's Bristol into the headlines. Tonight, from St. Paul's, TVI looks at how such excesses can be avoided in the future. Good evening from St. Paul's, Bristol. Of all the headlines that followed last week's rioting, this surely is the most important for the future. It must never happen again. And yet, if that hope, that determination are to be translated into lasting peace, we must try to understand what caused the violence last week. Not just the immediate spark, but why that spark could lead to such an angry outburst. Today in Bristol, community leaders are meeting together behind closed doors to talk about that very question. And in a few minutes, they'll be joining us in a local community centre to discuss with us the lessons of St. Paul's. And these may well need to be heeded in other areas with high black populations, in cities like London, Manchester, Birmingham, Liverpool, Leeds, Cardiff.
A week after all the looting, Bristol police are still wheeling in the stolen property, abandoned after being pillaged from gutted shops and showrooms. And there's no sign yet that the heavy police patrolling of St. Paul's is being relaxed. Arrests since the riots are nearing the 100 mark and are still rising.
The biggest problem in St. Paul's is the youngsters, the police aggression with the coloured youths around.
And police aggression?
Yes, police. They have pushed the boys too far. It's always been the police.
The charges of harassment are levelled against the police force as a whole, but it's the community constable in the front line.
I think, looking from now, a lot of people have talked about the bridges. Let's build some more bridges and perhaps we can get together. The bridges are still there. The only thing we've got to do now is to go across them and build from here. Things are bound to get better. And I think, in fact I know, that in the future, be it not in my lifetime, the problem we have now in every other city in this country will no longer exist.
The blacks of St. Paul's are nowhere near as optimistic. Last week's ugly confrontation gave public expression to a general grievance against authority and officialdom, a sense of grievance felt just as keenly in Britain's other inner cities. Half of St. Paul's 7,000 residents are black, most of them Jamaicans who came to Britain when we'd never had it so good. Many of the locals deny that St. Paul's is a ghetto, but it is the city's red light district, and young blacks have just as chilling a name for it, the jungle. On the housing front, big strides have been made in recent years. £13 million have been spent since 1974. But here, the future is less rosy. Because of public expenditure cuts, the local authority says there'll be no more money to start on new buildings or conversions from next year. Of the area's pitifully few amenities, there's doubt whether the adventure playground will even continue. A new generation of St. Paul's kids could be growing up with only the streets to play in. This derelict playground has got to close, and there's been foot dragging over the provision of a new one. The playground organiser, Steve Sweeney, believes there could be a change of heart after last week's riots.
I think we'll have to wait and see about that. You know, I think there is a possibility that people now notice it and will accept the arguments that we've been putting forward, that there is very little resources in the area for young people.
There's a financial question mark over this officially funded arts and community centre. But Alfredo Vasquez, the community arts worker, would be suspicious if last week's riots alone led to a change of heart.
I think it would be unfortunate if we were to sort of secure funding as a kind of a further palliative to the community, simply because of last Wednesday. I mean, it's not simply enough just to have community centres and other urban aid funded projects in the area, simply just as a way that the government can say, well, look, we're spending so much money on the area. I mean, the problems in this area are far deeper than simply the provision of community facilities in St. Paul's.
Over and above the lack of amenities in St Paul's, and probably central to last week's explosion of anger against white authority, is the issue of jobs. Bristol's jobless rate is 5.5%. Of Britain's biggest cities, only London's rate is lower. But in St Paul's, the jobless figures soar to 15%. And among the blacks, they could be much, much higher.
Well, a lot of them, the job was there, but the man just wouldn't give me the job. Just as simple as that.
There was a vacancy
and there wasn't no other applicant. But they still wouldn't give me the job.
Jobs for young blacks and the provision of those jobs at a time of rising unemployment. Just how far are we prepared to go in making an exception of our inner cities? On the right answer to that question may depend the prospects for racial peace.
Well, tonight, in the heart of St Paul's, in fact in the inkworks that was mentioned in Peter Gill's film report, we're going to take up some of those underlying grievances with members of the local community. At first, I'd like to ask you, Councillor Abraham, you're a Conservative councillor on the Conservative-controlled Avon Council. Do you understand the resentment of so many of the black community, especially young blacks in St Paul's? Do you feel that they are justified in regarding themselves, as so many of them seem to do, as underprivileged, even as oppressed?
No, I don't, quite frankly. We are spending, probably from a community point of view, more in this square mile than any other part of the county. We do treat it as a special area. My own committee, responsible for community affairs, is spending in excess of $100,000 a year in this particular area alone. We do support this particular project here. We pay full-time workers, nursery assistants. We have two youth centres, a community centre on top of this. Resentment comes, I think, in a lot of young people's minds from the very serious situation there is in unemployment. And we know there very closely that if you're from an ethnic background, that it is twice as difficult to get a job at the moment. Now, that must breed resentment, and I appreciate that, and we're doing all we can to solve that particular problem.
We'll come to that particular question a little bit later, but I'd like to bring in Roy de Freitas at this point. You're a community worker. Indeed, you've been meeting together today to try and discover what really lay behind what happened last week. How does the picture that you've been getting, the sentiments that were expressed there, for example, compare with the view taken by Councillor Abraham?
Well, I must say that in the 8 or 9 years I've lived in Bristol and worked in St Paul's in the eastern area, I've never felt such a feeling of unease beneath the surface. There have been the grumblings and the moans and the usual talks, but today's meeting, not very much was said, but the feeling that was coming out suggests that it is far from over yet.
Why do you think that the unease has intensified? You said you've never felt it quite as bad as this.
Well, I think that because a start has been made in letting the host community know what the black community feels, and many people feel that when this is all over, in a week or two, or a few months, it would go back to being what it was before. Primarily because the local authorities, Avon and Bristol, have already laid their cards on the table. That is, we have spent so much money here, and we have spent so much money there. But none of that money has spent with the black community. Look, there are no members of the black community directly receiving any direct aid or benefit from it. The money is spent on workers, maybe, and on buildings. But the buildings are not the type of buildings or the type of things that the black community wants. It's not building.
Can I go a little bit further than what the black community want and don't want? With you, Desmond Pierre, you are St Paul's Defence Committee. What is it that St Paul's is defending itself against?
Well, firstly, I must tell you, we're not even defending ourselves against the police. We're defending ourselves on a lot of issues. But the main one is just the right to live a free life in any country, no matter whether it be England and anywhere. But as black people, our first and utmost thing is for freedom. And even here in England, our mother country, as it's so called, there is no freedom for us.
In what way is your freedom being impinged upon?
Well, my personal freedom the infringement on it is the same as most black people. Like, for me to be here today speaking on this television program, I know a lot of youths in the area wouldn't come because they know tomorrow they'd be picked up by the police, or maybe later tonight. Little infringements like that alone. As Roy DeFreitas said, he has other social workers in the area. They've had various grants and so on. Him himself has got a building right in front of the very newest police station, a very big fortress that everything that's happened here in the last week and so on, that's where it's happening. Right in front of his building that they give him for black people. And yet still right in front of him is one of the biggest torture houses for black people right now. We've got a smooth gentleman on my right-hand side here who can come and quote us figures from the government or the local council and whole heap of different organization. We have a whole heap of different organization up and down the country that says they're helping black people, but that is not their aim. Their aim is every time we're oppressed to come along and immediately quell the problem until the next time come along. But we don't want that no more.
Can I ask Councillor Abraham to respond to that? You did speak earlier about understanding a degree of resentment, but the force of that resentment, as Desmond Pierre expressed it, is something else, isn't it?
Well, I really just don't accept what has been said at all. I think that when you talk in emotive terms about a fortress, this is just a police station he's talking about. Is he really saying he doesn't want law and order? Because the people I'm talking to in St. Paul's are very worried about what happened last week, and what they want is law and order, and what they want is a police presence.
Councillor, can I ask you this? Are you worried about the situation that's really happening in St. Paul right now? Are you worried about your long-term prospects in job-wise in keeping the situation under control level for yourself?
Let him answer that. May he answer that?
Of course I am worried what's happening, because I'm worried for the city that I love and live in. I am a Bristolian, I'm very proud of our city. I'm proud of the fact that for hundreds of years that we've had fantastically good relationships with our coloured friends.
That is not true.
Now, I think that there has been a breakdown.
I really must say
that, you know, for Roy to say that we're not doing anything directly to help black people is absolutely wrong. This very building we're in is here to accommodate and help at a community level black people.
Will it survive the cuts?
It has survived the cuts.
And it
will. You're wrong, because that man is on the one of your very, probably your very scheme. And yet still, he's got to come out now, as he said to you. This is the first time he's ever felt any feeling so hostility that even him himself now cannot turn away from the situation. Him himself has got to come out and show himself that he's afraid, because that is what he is.
He's afraid. I want to hear another view. I want to hear the view of Adrian Smith. You're a headmaster at a local primary school. Can I ask you, and you've been in that job for some years, were you surprised by what happened last week? Did you see it coming?
We spoke to the former Education Authority, Bristol, 7 years ago as a group of teachers, and we asked for facilities. We asked for things to be done. We got a response, but it's taken 7 years to even get as far as we have. Now, I do hope and I believe that the new County Council will respond. There is a desperate need to get something moving right now.
Well, what is the pattern that you see, or the development of the people who go to the primary school that you see and who then have to leave the area, as I understand it, to go to a school outside the area afterwards? Now, how does that affect them, and what sort of pattern of development do you see in that?
Yes, well, the general situation as far as primary school children are concerned is that on the whole, and this is a generalisation, on the whole they are treated with sensitivity, and at the age of 11 they transfer to schools adjacent to the St Paul's area, where perhaps through maybe lack of experience, probably not lack of sympathy, but lack of experience, they are meeting a different kind of approach in the schools. And perhaps now I even may be able to say, with the government, there may be a need for a secondary school in or very close to the St Paul's area, where the children will have empathy with the teachers who are working with them, and therefore the community leaders. But the whole thing does hinge on sensitivity, not on training, not on token gestures towards the community. It does demand real sensitivity by people who are trying, they would say, their best to get something done. But it hasn't worked at the moment.
Can I ask a question here? Seeing as we'd like this discussion to be very open and more towards the community and the way we're living and so on, in the position that you've explained, how do you see your position to go on from here tomorrow?
I find it quite difficult. The only thing I can do is look over my shoulder and, perhaps with tongue in cheek, say to you, I believe other teachers have been trying to get something done, but I think we've got to look at it again now and really get down to the nitty-gritty of the whole
thing. Do you think the teachers that are here right now can cope with the problem of the youth and their culture right now, here, especially...
The teachers serving at this present time?
Yeah.
Not all of them, no.
Well, that's one of all our problems and things like that. The kind of teachers that we want, it's got to come from within ourselves. It's not that the grants and things like that don't come towards black people and so on, but the schemes that they're set up with just cannot help black people, because the system that it falls to is a system that we can't penetrate.
Roy de Freitas, on that same point, the need for black people to work for black people.
Well, this is a point I've made earlier, and this is the point Mr. Abrams seemed to have totally, completely lost. You can spend another £100 million in St. Paul's. It won't make any difference to Bristol black people. It isn't a question of St. Paul's. It isn't the buildings and like this you put up. It's the people. It's not a St. Paul's problem. It's a Bristol black community problem.
And what do you spend the money? What should you spend the money on?
On the people. You know, Avon haven't got enough black teachers or black social workers or black community workers or anyone who has the eyes and ears of the black community, no one they actually respect. Desmond mentioned that I have a big building in front of the newest, grandest police station. That has stood there for 4 years without a penny from Avon County or Bristol City Council. We've gone in there with £3,000 and we're doing half your job today. And it's not even recognized by Avon. And these are black people. There are something like 15 black people inside there working without a penny, voluntary work. But it's not recognized.
What chance is there?
Just a moment.
Very well.
Right next door, they've built a brand new police station and fill it with policemen, and they can find the money to pay them. And across the road, they built a huge sports center, which has not even been used by the people of Eastern.
Where they give the black people at church hall and tell them that they must go dance upon grieve.
Can I bring Councillor Abram back in? Mr. Abram, is there any chance of coming to terms with problems like this at a time when public expenditure cuts are limiting what any government and any local government operation can achieve, and indeed also at a time when you've got rising unemployment, which is very high, as you know, amongst the black population, when the Manpower Services Commission, with which you're associated, is actually phasing out some of the jobs which it provided?
Can I be clear on that very last point? They're not phasing out. They are committed to job opportunity schemes at the level that they were last year, and we still are accommodating. There was one section of the scheme for older people that was cut, but not the job opportunities, and we have over 1,000 young people on those schemes at this very moment in time, and quite a high number of those are coloured young people who are finding jobs after going through one of the schemes. So it really is a success story there.
How can you give a young child a job prospect by standing on his foot on one hand and sending him out there to look a job that he just isn't going to get? Don't matter how much time him try, he just isn't gonna get it. At the same time, the system have him in houses and things like that, that he cannot cope with bills then that he cannot pay, and yet still there's no money coming in from nowhere. What do you want him to do?
Could I ask you a question, Desmond Pierre, on that? I mean, I got an extraordinary figure from the Department of Employment which suggests that there only were 70 young blacks registered at the job centres. Do black people not want to register, or really is it not as serious a problem as you make out?
Would you spend your life following a system that you know before you even start is not going to accept anything you try, don't matter how hard you try? That's why I say it doesn't matter how much money you spend within our communities to help us. If you're not going to let us take an active part in it for ourselves, that at the end of the day, we own what we have and it is ours, that we can use it to the best ethnic in our culture then. And maybe then we can live alongside in a community.
Can I ask you generally on a final point, whether you feel that with the economic stress that the country faces at a time like that, when there are cuts, as I've mentioned already, all round, can the problems of St. Paul's be resolved and others
are you hopeful that this can happen? We're not talking about St. Paul's, we're talking about Bristol black community.
But we're not even talking about Bristol. This is the feeling of the whole country. People all over the country feeling these things.
That is the question that I was trying to put. The problems of St. Paul's and other areas like them throughout the country.
Well, I'm saddened from what I've heard, particularly from this gentleman on my left, because I really feel that there's no future for us if we go on talking in this sort of way. Surely we must... He tells us that he can't buck the system, that the system is there, but they won't register unemployed if they're unemployed. I don't understand that, quite frankly. I'm sure that many, many coloured young people will want to work together with their white counterparts. We do have a future. We have a future together that will be successful and will blot last week out of Bristol's history forever. I'm confident.
No,
Roy de Bretis has had less to say than you. I'm sorry, but I want to give him a word here. Beg your pardon.
I think it's time Mr. Abrams sit down and talk more with us, because you seem to know very little about us, about what we need, what we know, and what we feel. You have your figures, your facts, your statistics, you have your workers, but they are none of us.
But they are. We have a coloured specialist officer area dealing with your
job. Could you finish?
He's not one of us. He doesn't know us.
Well, I don't know why that is the case.
He's the most disrespectful person in Bristol City by any of these black youngsters.
That's not true.
Well, as to government response as to what happened in St. Paul's last week, it's for the Home Office to consider when they get it, the report on police activity here. Some of the other matters that we've discussed tonight are mainly the concern of the, and indeed matters which relate to other inner cities, of the Department of the Environment, where I spoke to the minister concerned, Mr. Tom King, and I asked him whether, in the light of the violence in St. Paul's, the social costs of the government's cutbacks in public expenditure might not become too high to be borne.
Well, this is precisely why we didn't cut the inner city programme. In the various public expenditure cuts that were necessary when we came into office, the one programme that we deliberately protected from the economies was the inner city programme, which was spending something over £150 million, because we recognise that these areas do face particular problems. It is a new programme, and we want to maintain the momentum for it. But one thing I would say, it isn't either a question just of public money. You are interviewing me here now. I've just come out of a conference which is being held of American and British ministers, industrialists, talking about the American as well as the British experience, in which companies have shown, big companies, the contribution that they can make in helping in the inner city programs. For instance, in America, you can look at the contribution that General Motors have made to Detroit and the environment of Detroit, and British companies are playing an increasing part in helping inner city problems as well.
But do you feel that British companies have the financial strength and the will to make a major impact on the kind of problems we're talking about now?
They're making not only a financial contribution, but they've got a tremendous contribution they can make in resources. What they are doing a lot of is helping to start small businesses and giving advice and often lending people to small businesses to get them going and to help them start up.
Turning to government's role, Minister, Bristol currently wants, they say, £19 million for house building and rehabilitation of old housing. They're going to get £11.8 million. And they say they can't go ahead with any new projects with those resources. Now, isn't that going to be disastrous for a place like St. Paul's?
Well, we've got to look at this, obviously, in the totality of public expenditure. We would like to be very nice if we had lots of money to spend in every city in this country. The problem, as you know at the moment, is the British economy is not producing the funds to sustain those levels of public expenditure. Then it becomes a question of the competing claims of other cities in the United Kingdom. But that's why it's so important not just to look automatically to the government and say, is there more public money? When actually we all know in our hearts that there isn't limitless public money.
But isn't
that's why what I'm trying to emphasize, just is such an important point, this, that people look at the ways in which contributions can come from other sources as well. And that's why I'm at this very moment having this conference to discuss the ways in which help can come from other sources as well as public funds.
Mr. Tom King. And finally, we've heard today that another government minister, Lord Gowrie of the Department of Employment, is due to visit Bristol tomorrow. And from what we've been hearing this evening, he'll have much to occupy his mind during his visit. From TVI in St. Paul's, Bristol, good night.